Recorded Books presents The Monarchs by Kass Morgan and Danielle Paige. Narrated by Sophie Amoss. To our editorial coven, Lainey, Laura, Ellen, and Amelia, your words are magic. Kass. For my sister Andrea, when we were small, I used to follow you around like the sun. I love you, sis. I still would follow you anywhere. And for Fee and Sienna, my little coven, Danielle. Prologue. Long dead eyes blink open in the crypt. The first thing they sense is the absence of darkness. Light filters in through the tiniest of holes. Lungs fill with air and ache with the pleasure of pain after so many years empty. In and out. A piercing scream erupts from a hungry throat, but the walls of the tomb constrain it. Hands claw at the sides of the box until bone and blood meet stone. And then panic sets in as remembrance begins to take hold of what happened, of who built the walls of this cursed prison. The witches did, of course. The witches. Where are they? It doesn't take long. There it is. The sweet perfume of magic. The witches. They are to blame. And they are still here. I can feel them. One witch, two witch, three witch. They've brought the wind. It howls overhead, an almost human keening screech. It tears through the branches of the tree, whipping off limbs and leaves, tossing them like confetti to the ground below. It circles and rages, diving to the earth and destroying everything in its path. They've brought the rain, a soaking, furious storm, shot through with thunder and lightning. Amid it all, three girls, a cups witch, a pentacles witch, and most wicked of them all, a swords witch. The one desperate to defy the laws of nature. A tree falls. Glass shatters. One by one, the witches fall to the ground, and the wicked one doesn't get up. They've shaken the earth. It rumbles. And then everything just stops. The wind goes still. The rain vanishes as quickly as it appeared. The clouds part in the moonless sky. The witches are too busy crying to notice anything but their grief. No one feels it. The way the world split apart. A deep, jagged cut in the beaten earth. And no one sees it. The pale, dirt-covered hand that emerges from the deep, clawing its way to the surface.
I am free. I am coming for them.
A voice whispers into the dark. No one can hear. No one else knows. But vengeance is coming.
One witch, two witch, three witch, none.
Chapter 1. Scarlet.
What you're suggesting sounds like you want to change what it means to be a Kappa witch.
Eugenie accused Scarlet, passing their mother a serving dish of truffled mashed potatoes.
The end of winter break can't come soon enough, Scarlet Winter thought, as she sat trapped at home between two Kappa alumni, who just happened to be her mother and sister, at their last supper before she got to go back to Westerly College.
Scarlet took a deep breath to calm herself. Looking at Eugenie, Scarlet wished that she was back with her sisters again. Her real sisters. The Ravens. It had been 3 weeks since the Kappa girls bid one another farewell, after the most difficult term of Scarlet's life. And while they'd been texting constantly, it didn't feel the same. Sure, her mother Marjorie and sister Eugenie had been marginally less terrible to Scarlet recently, but that was before Scarlet made her proposal at tonight's dinner.
I'm sure that's not what your sister means,
Right, honey? Marjorie asked gently. Well, no. And yes, Scarlett said carefully. But just then, her phone vibrated. It was tucked out of sight underneath her thigh to avoid her mother complaining about phones at the dinner table. But she hadn't been able to resist smuggling it into the dining room tonight because of Jackson. Jackson, who she most definitely should not be encouraging, or even texting. Jackson, who she'd cast a memory charm on to make him forget her. See? I told you, she's trying to tear Kappa down from within, Eugenie said with a smug look. Scarlett took the opportunity to glance down at her phone. She lives. When I didn't hear from you for a whole day, I began to worry. Scarlett bit her lip to keep a smile from forming. Scarlett? Marjorie pressed. Scarlett shoved the thought of her complicated love life aside and folded her palms on the table. She needed her mother's approval tonight, but she wasn't appealing to her mother as her mother. She was appealing to her as the head of the Kappa Alumni Council, the Monarchs. She was the crucial piece to getting the other witches to fall in line. Sometimes convincing one witch was the key to them all. I do want to change things, Mama, so that what happened last semester never happens again. And you think having every Kappa write down all her secrets accomplishes that? It exposes us to the greatest risk of all, discovery. I've thought of that. I've thought of everything. I am a winter, aren't I? At this, Scarlett sat a little taller. Truthfully, she had thought of everything. There had been nothing to do these past 3 weeks but think. Marjorie sighed. What happened last semester was an anomaly, but it is behind us. Let's leave the past in the past. That was exactly what Scarlett was afraid of, that those who hadn't been there wouldn't understand what real danger truly felt like, what it felt like when your best friend went to the wicked side and killed 3 other witches just to make herself more powerful. That's precisely the problem. The past isn't the past. The past is what came back to haunt us, and we didn't know about it. We weren't prepared for it, because we don't know our own history. If only they'd known about the Hnosis talisman, maybe they would have been able to stop Tiffany sooner. Maybe they could have saved Dahlia, their former president. Her mother paused, considering. Tell me more about this survey you want to conduct. Marjorie Winters pursed her lips. Her emphasis on the word was slight enough that most people wouldn't have noticed, but Scarlett knew her mother well enough to hear the doubt. Yes, sister, do explain why you think invading our alumni's privacy worthwhile, Eugenie butted in. Ignoring the skeletons in our own closet came back to haunt us last semester. And I don't want to let anything like that happen again. We can all agree there, Marjorie murmured, which raised Scarlett's spirits just a hint. She squared her shoulders. I want to ask everyone to submit a personal account of their time at Kappa. It doesn't have to include anything private. I'm not interested in a sordid history of hookups. Just information about the spell work they performed with the sorority, especially group workings. Any historical information about the Kappa House or Westerly itself? Marjorie raised a hand, cutting off her daughter. I'm sorry, honey, but Kappa Rho Nu has always placed a very high value on privacy. You really expect some of the most powerful women in the country to voluntarily hand you written proof they're witches? Eugenie smirked. No, of course not, she replied, just as disdainfully. She had anticipated this objection, too. She reached into the vintage Hermes bag her mother had gifted her over the holidays. Scarlett had always admired this bag, which her mother had gotten decades ago in Paris. It was enchanted to feel weightless on your shoulder. An even better gift than the bag itself, however, had been the expression on Eugenie's face when Scarlett had opened it. This bag was a reminder. Marjorie respected Scarlett now, trusted her. After everything that happened last semester, after seeing what Tiffany became, surely her mother would see the wisdom in this plan. Scarlett withdrew a leather-bound book. The cover had been embossed with two stylized tarot card images, the moon and the magician. As she flipped it open, she whispered under her breath, "I call to the moon and to the magician. Reveal the wellspring of my sister's ambitions." Eugenie sat back in her chair and crossed her arms, unimpressed. Marjorie, on the other hand, leaned closer. The blank pages bloomed with black letters, so straight and solid they looked typewritten. "Interesting. So the enchantment protects the anonymity of the contributors?" Scarlett nodded. "And if the book detects signs of any non-Kappa witches attempting to tamper, it will wipe itself blank." She fanned through the pages, tightly blinking her eyes closed when she spotted May's entry about last semester. "I've already collected the current Kappa's memories to demonstrate. My plan is to ask the Monarchs at the alumni reunion to join us in a group ritual, to add any information they choose."
The spell is impressive.
Marjorie tapped a nail on the hardwood as Scarlett snapped the book shut. She was quiet for a long moment.
"Very well. We'll need to discuss this at the next council meeting."
Eugenie heaved a sigh. "I suppose we ought to put it to vote," she said. Scarlett blinked, stunned by her sister's support. "Oh, okay. Well, thank you." Then Eugenie grinned. "I do enjoy watching new proposals fail. Makes for such entertaining arguments at cocktail hour afterward." Of course. Her sister would never truly back her, no matter how much she accomplished, no matter what strides she made. After all, her sister had come home for dinner tonight of all nights. The one night Scarlett specifically asked her mother if they could dine alone, because she wanted to talk Kappa business. Eugenie claimed it was because she wanted to spend more time with her younger sister. But Scarlett knew the truth. Eugenie was jealous. Worried Scarlett might usurp her place as the most noteworthy Kappa president in the family. Well, good, Scarlett thought with a tight smile. That was exactly what she intended to do. "Besides," Eugenie continued, while she reached for the bell to call the housekeeper, "from what I hear, you won't need to dig around in ancient history for a fight. You've got your work cut out for you right here in the present." "What do you mean?" Scarlett asked, forcing her expression to remain calm. Eugenie flashed a smug smile. "Rumor has it Kappa won't be the only ones putting in a bid with the Pan-Hellenic Council to host Spring Fling this year. Theta's coming for you." Scarlett actually laughed. "Is that all?" She'd been expecting far worse. Theta Omega Xi, the second largest sorority on Westerly's campus, counterbidding Kappa for the Spring Fling, wasn't exactly news. Their rivalry went back nearly as far as the founding of Westerly.
"Maria begs the council to let her host every year," Scarlett said. "I wouldn't call one jealous sorority president a threat, especially not after what happened last summer."
Even more than the other sororities and fraternities on campus, Theta historically took pride in adhering to practices like strict dress codes and rigid rules of conduct. Last summer, someone leaked sections from the handbook online, and it'd gone viral almost instantly. A graphic showing how to match different shades of white had garnered particular ridicule, as had a chapter on clothing styles and body types. It had been a PR disaster. Everyone assumed it was a disgruntled Theta who leaked the book, but no one knew for certain.
"Underestimating your enemy is the first step toward failure," Eugenie replied as the maid entered.
"Oh, Beth, darling, we're about ready for dessert."
Scarlett smiled icily at her sister as the new housekeeper entered with a cart carrying biscuits and clotted cream, placing one at each of their play settings. Scarlett took a bite of the biscuit and was immediately transported back in time. It tasted like her childhood, like safety and love and innocence. It tasted like Minnie.
Mama, how did you?
Scarlett turned toward Marjorie.
Minnie, her beloved nanny, had passed away nearly a year ago.
It's Beth. She's a cups and an empath. We thought this dessert would be a nice treat,
Marjorie said with a magnanimous smile. Scarlett knew what her mother was doing. Marjorie Winter believed in throwing one of two things at a problem, money or magic. After what Scarlett went through last semester, her mother had been pulling out all the stops. Scarlett pushed the plate away. Her mother was trying to be kind, but she didn't know her like Minnie had. Minnie would have known that there was no substitute for Minnie's cooking, just like there was no substitute for Minnie herself. Scarlett suddenly felt a strong and irrepressible urge to be alone.
Actually, I've got some classwork to finish.
She waited just long enough for Marjorie to nod in dismissal and then strode away. Only once she was safely shut in her bedroom did she let the tears flow. A moment later, raindrops pattered against her window and thunder rumbled in the distance, summoned by her cup's magic, by her tears. Before she'd understood her special connection to water, she'd been scared of storms like these. She used to sneak into Minnie's room and curl up next to her, shaking.
Don't be afraid, little one. The water is part of you. It is your magic, Minnie would murmur, wrapping an arm around Scarlett's shoulders. It's funny, though, how something so destructive can be so beautiful at the same time.
With Minnie, everything was part lesson, part protection, part love. And Scarlett was forever grateful for every word. They'd kept her alive. They'd kept her safe. Scarlett thought about Tiffany, her best friend, who had caved in to her desire for power, who killed people for it, her own sisters included. She was beautiful and destructive, too.
Don't be afraid, but be wary, Minnie always said when she sensed fear in Scarlett. You are the storm, but there are other storms out there, too.
Over time, Minnie's words came to fruition. Scarlett's powers had grown over the years, and she had summoned a storm the night that Tiffany had threatened her life and Vivi's. Minnie had been right. She was the storm, but Tiffany had been one, too. But then the thought brought a pang of guilt with it. Only her Kappas understood. They knew the real story, and they felt the same loss. Once they were back under the same roof, she'd feel better again, more grounded and centered, more at home. Yet another reason she longed to be back at Westerly again. Scarlett rooted around in her bag until she found her tarot deck, not the shiny new deck her mother had given her at the start of the school year, the old, tattered one Minnie had given her years ago. The edges on the cards were worn, and some had been bent or stained in places. But this deck knew Scarlett, understood her heart. It always gave honest answers, even when those answers were hard to hear. A distant rumble rattled the window panes. Scarlett held the deck in both hands and focused on the coming semester, on her new presidency at Kappa, on her and her sister's chance to rebuild. Their fresh start after the horrors of the fall. Spring brought new life, rebirth, rejuvenation. They desperately needed that now.
Show me what this semester holds in store for Kappa, Scarlett whispered to the cards.
To Minnie, if she was listening somewhere. Scarlett fanned the cards out across her bed, then ran her fingertips over them. Her skin tingled when she touched one card. She withdrew it from the fan and made another pass. The next card jumped from the deck of its own accord before she even reached it. The third card followed.
Scarlett swept all three up, laid them face down before her, and took a deep, centering breath. The first card represented Kappa's recent past. She turned it over. The Tower. Danger. Destruction. A sudden and terrible upheaval. Well, that's certainly accurate. The second card would represent her and her sister's present. She held her breath as she flipped it. Three of Swords. The image depicted a bleeding heart, pierced by three swords. Grief, heartbreak, loss. Swords had been Tiffany's suit, Scarlett couldn't help but note. Each of the three swords reminded Scarlett of someone they'd lost. Tiffany, Dahlia, and Gwyn, their former sorority sisters. Scarlett swallowed hard as she reached for the final card. The future. It would indicate what the Kappas should expect in the semester to come. Please give us some good news. They needed it. But when she saw the card, her heart sank. The Ten of Swords. An image of a man lying face down on the ground, 10 swords protruding from his backside. Betrayal, enemies, curses and attacks. A flash lit up the bedroom, so blindingly white it seared the backs of Scarlett's eyes. A flash of anger followed. She shoved the cards so hard they spilled onto the floor. She paced over to the window and stared out into the storm. A storm nearly as violent as the one she and Tiffany had battled the night her best friend died just a month ago. It felt like years. I don't care what the gods say, Scarlett whispered to her own reflection. I'll make this semester better, no matter what it takes. Her only reply was the rumble of thunder overhead. Chapter 2. Vivi.
Oh, look. There's a spot right in front. That's a good sign, isn't it, Sugar Snap?
Vivi shot her mother a suspicious glance from the driver's seat. Daphne Devereaux saw signs everywhere. Omens of misfortune in tarot cards, portents of doom in tea leaves, and hints of danger in the cackle of crows. But she never, ever saw good signs. Nor did she usually speak in the slow, overly cheerful tone people employed to soothe toddlers or disarm axe murderers. Vivi knew her mother was trying to help alleviate her concerns about returning to Westerly College, and more specifically, Kappa House, the elegant Savannah mansion about a half mile from the spot in the woods where Vivi had nearly been killed last semester. But while her brush with death had forced Vivi to accept that magic had a dangerous side, Vivi knew she would face any threat with her sisters by her side. After all, the Kappas were one of the most powerful covens in the country.
Are you sure we'll fit there? Vivi asked.
You can't avoid parallel parking forever. We should have practiced more over the holidays, Daphne said with a sigh.
I'm not avoiding it, Vivi said indignantly. It's fine, I can do it.
She took a deep breath, straightened out the car, and had just started backing up when she spotted three Pika brothers coming down the block. Despite the fact that it was just after 11 a.m., all three were holding red Solo cups. Vivi rolled her eyes. Frat bros.
Here we go, parking challenge commenced, one of the boys shouted as he raised his cup in the air. The championship is on the line, but can the Americans pull through at the 11th hour? Another said in a deep announcer's voice.
Just ignore them, honey pie, Daphne said, suppressing a smile. She was generally deeply distrusting of men, but had a soft spot for boys with preppy swagger that Vivi had always found somewhat mystifying. Her cheeks burning, Vivi grasped the wheel and whispered, I call to the High Priestess and the Page of Swords. Lend me the skills that practice affords.
The final syllable had barely left her mouth when her body began to fill with a comforting warmth, as if someone had wrapped her in a weighted electric blanket. All the tension drained from her shoulders, and almost without thinking about it, Vivi backed the car into the parking spot in one smooth movement, guided by muscle memory she hadn't before possessed. She shot the boys a triumphant look. The one who'd taken out his phone gave her a thumbs up. The other two had already lost interest and were walking down the block. Daphne shook her head. "You're going to get spoiled, using your magic for every little task. I thought you agreed that I need to practice. I was thinking more about self-defense, sweetheart, not parallel parking," Daphne said, glancing over her shoulder at the retreating pikas. "And I definitely didn't mean you should practice in front of strange boys." Vivi snorted. "Those frat boys wouldn't recognize magic unless their beer bongs came to life and started singing along to Florida Georgia Line. And even then, they'd probably blame it on bad weed. I wouldn't lump all fraternity boys together if I were you. I knew quite a few impressive ones in my day." Daphne's face turned slightly wistful, a rare expression that could only mean one thing. She was thinking about the one person they never, ever discussed. "Was my father in a frat?" Vivi asked, careful to keep her tone casual, lest Daphne shut down or change the subject like she usually did whenever she felt Vivi pushing too hard. "Of course, Vince was the quarterback. He joined the football fraternity." Vivi froze. Vince. Her mother had always refused to tell Vivi her father's name, lest she get any ideas about Googling him or tracking him down. It was by far the most information Daphne had ever divulged in one conversation, enough to make Vivi bold enough to ask, "So he went to Westerly with you?" Daphne pretended to be too busy gathering her purse and unbuckling her seatbelt to hear. "All set? Let's start taking these bags inside." Although it was the third week of January, all the houses on their block still had their Christmas lights up, except for Kappa House, which had forgone decorations this year in the wake of their president's death. In the many other places she'd lived, Vivi had found holiday decorations in January rather depressing. They seemed to signal a dejected weariness that matched the dreary expressions of their occupants. But Savannah was an entirely different story. The elegant, slightly weather-worn mansions with Christmas lights peeking out from overgrown ivy reminded Vivi of an eccentric party girl who'd fallen asleep in her pearls. "Do you want me to help carry this stuff up to your room?" Daphne asked from near the car. "I'll be okay," Vivi whispered another spell she'd been practicing under her breath. The overstuffed duffel bag turned feather light, and the suitcases on the steps levitated a few inches off the ground. Without thinking, she glanced over her shoulder toward the forest behind Kappa House and shivered as she remembered the manic gleam in Tiffany's eye, the moonlight glinting off the dagger she held pointed over Vivi's chest. For a moment, she was transported back to that clearing. She could hear the crack of thunder, the snap of shattered branches as the storm raged. The smell of rain-soaked dirt mingled with the scent of her own blood. The ground beneath her trembled, yanking her back to the present. "What the?" She jerked her head from side to side, looking for the source. A huge truck rumbling down the street, or a construction crew with enormous drills. But there was nothing. Everything was still and quiet. Daphne, who apparently hadn't felt anything, pulled Vivi in for a tight hug. "Take care of yourself, sweetheart."
"I will, I promise."
"I love you, darling," Daphne said, then released her.
"Love you too."
She smiled and waved as her mother turned back to the car, thinking how much had changed in just a few months. Vivi had arrived at Westerly desperate to start a new life away from Daphne and her constant premonitions of doom. but now she felt a pain in her chest as she watched her mother drive away. However, her flicker of homesickness lasted just about as long as it took Vivi to turn around and see Etta standing in the doorway, a huge grin on her face.
"You're back," Etta said,
pulling Vivi in for a hug. As usual, she smelled faintly of lavender and mint from all the time she spent tending to the garden and the more exotic plants in the greenhouse.
"Come in. Do you need help with those?"
She gestured toward Vivi's bags.
"I'm okay."
Vivi snapped her fingers, and the suitcases began floating toward her.
"Wow," Etta said, impressed. "Someone's been practicing."
Vivi followed her into the foyer, smiling at the tea rose printed wallpaper and the curved mahogany table next to the brass coat rack. The first floor of the house was glamored to adapt to the seasons, time of day, or just the general mood of the occupants, but this iteration was her favorite.
"The first floor was all mid-century modern until about 10 minutes ago," Etta said. "The house must have sensed you coming."
"There you are,"
May said, coming down the wide staircase. Her wet hair was waist length today and bright pink. "Did you wind up trying those charms I sent?" May, the only other pentacles witch in the house, had taken it upon herself to flood Vivi's inbox with spells that specialized in earth magic.
"Yes, thank you. That last one was amazing."
May had sent her a spell that allowed the user to summon stones from the ground to create a shield. Practicing it over and over in her mother's garden had made Vivi feel calmer and safer than she had since leaving the woods. She'd be damned if anyone caught her off her guard again. From somewhere inside the house, Vivi heard a muffled shout, and an instant later, a squealing mass crashed into her.
"I thought you'd never get here!"
Ariana wrapped both arms around Vivi's middle and squeezed.
"Did y'all walk from Jackal Island? Or did you stop to see Mason first?"
"Yeah, you caught me,"
Vivi teased.
"I decided to take my mother along with me to see my boyfriend."
It was the first time she had said the word boyfriend aloud to describe Mason. It was actually the first time in her entire life she'd called anyone her boyfriend.
"I knew I heard our favorite badass,"
Reagan said. She appeared in the hallway alongside Sonali, who rushed forward to give Vivi nearly as crushing a hug as Ariana.
"How are you holding up?"
Sonali asked, stepping back to examine Vivi critically. She had spent the break working in a hospital in a small Peruvian mountain town with terrible cell service, and it had driven her crazy not to be able to FaceTime with Vivi and track her recovery.
"Relax, Dr. Manny, she's fine," Reagan said, reaching out to fluff Vivi's hair. "She's never looked better. I'm the one you should have been worrying about. My mom's become obsessed with me dating a senator's son and dragged me to 8 different DC Christmas parties. If I have to listen to one more Chad or Luke tell me about playing lacrosse at Dartmouth or rowing at Princeton, I'm going to hex my ears off."
"That should definitely solve the problem," Ariana said. "No self-respecting lacrosse bro is going to date a girl with no ears." She linked her arm through Vivi's. "Come on, there's iced tea waiting for you in the garden. I want to hear all about things with Mason."
"I'm not sure there's much to tell, but let me take my stuff upstairs and I'll meet you out there."
Vivi smiled and headed toward the stairs, her enchanted bags drifting behind her. She and Mason hadn't been able to meet up over the break, but they'd spoken every day. It was delightfully strange that her former crush and Scarlett's ex-boyfriend was now the first person she thought to reach out to when she was panicking about course registration or simply wanted to share a silly dog video. However, there was a limit to how close they'd ever be able to grow, since there was a part of her life that had to remain hidden forever. Under no circumstances could Vivi reveal that magic was real, and that Kappa Rho Nu was a sorority for witches. She passed the second floor and paused to admire the deep blue walls hung with antique mirrors, candle sconces, and oil paintings of famous witches and powerful magical sites around the world. Vivi loved the dramatic glamour of this floor. But no part of the house made her happier than the sunny third floor, with its gabled ceilings and whitewashed walls, where she, Ariana, and Bailey each had one of the singles reserved for first-year sisters. But before she could slip into her bedroom, a voice caught her attention. "It definitely wasn't like this earlier," Bailey was saying, worriedly. "Do you think a bird flew into it or something?" Bailey and Scarlett were standing in front of one of the bay windows, looking out over the garden. It had a window seat where Vivi had spent hours curled up reading, with a mug of tea bewitched to stay piping hot until the final drop. "Everything okay?"
"Vivi," Bailey said, "you're back."
She gave Vivi a quick hug, then returned her attention to the window. She was fiddling with the hem of her sweater, like she always did when she was nervous.
"I'm back," Vivi repeated.
"Hey, Scarlett." But to her surprise, her big merely gave her a quick smile before leaning in to inspect the window, where a huge spiderweb-shaped crack filled one of the panes.
"I'm sure it's nothing," Scarlett said, running one of her perfectly manicured fingers along the crack.
As usual, she was impeccably turned out in a tweed shift dress and pearls befitting the newest president of Kappa Rho Nu.
"In old houses like this, the foundation settles sometimes."
It was true that the house often creaked and groaned, especially during storms, but Vivi couldn't imagine the foundation shifting enough to crack a window.
"I thought I felt something out in the yard a few minutes ago, sort of a weird tremor."
Vivi could have sworn she saw a flicker of alarm in Scarlett's face before she smiled and said briskly,
"There you go."
It was probably one of the moving trucks passing too close to the house. "Are you all right to fix it yourself, or would you like help?"
"I've got it," Bailey said confidently.
"Great. I'll see you girls downstairs in 5. I'm calling a house meeting."
"Sure," Vivi said, about to ask how Scarlett's break had been. But her big was already hurrying down the steps.
The living room was full by the time Vivi stashed her suitcases in her bedroom and then ran back downstairs for the meeting. She smiled and waved at the Kappas she hadn't seen yet as she picked her way through the packed room toward Ariana, who scooted over to make room on a blue velvet footrest that matched the armchair in which Jess and Juliet were snuggled up. The only person still standing was Scarlett. She stepped forward, and a respectful quiet fell over the room.
"Welcome back, ladies," she said, her voice the perfect blend of warmth and authority. "I hope y'all had the relaxing, restorative breaks you deserved. Last semester, we faced the greatest threat in our coven's history, and we emerged even stronger for it. When Kappas stand together, there's nothing we can't do."
She paused and rested her gaze on the one empty seat in the room, the red brocade chair next to the fireplace, where Dahlia always sat during meetings.
"But we also suffered tragic loss."
Vivi's throat tightened. In a just world, Dahlia would be here, welcoming the girls back to campus with one of her businesslike but still darkly funny speeches, instead of lying cold and silent beneath a newly dug grave in Bonaventure Cemetery.
"Dahlia isn't here in body, but we all know she's here in spirit. We will continue to feel her presence. We will always feel her magic. Let's have a moment of silence for our sister." Our sisters.
She's referring to Tiffany, Vivi realized, as a few of the Kappas exchanged uneasy looks. Tiffany had been Scarlett's best friend before she'd become obsessed with the Hinosis talisman, a legendary amulet she'd hoped to use to cure her mother's terminal illness. But while her intentions had been noble, the wicked magic had proved too powerful for Tiffany, sending her down a desperate, twisted path that resulted in her killing Dahlia to steal her magic. In the end, Scarlett had been forced to battle her own best friend to save Vivi, a newbie witch who hadn't been strong enough to fight back. Guilt tugged at Vivi's chest. "It wasn't your fault," she reminded herself. The thought felt hollow. She squeezed her eyes shut, but her mind continued to race. She saw the forest, the dark clearing. Her heart beat faster, wild and frantic, the same way it had that night. She could smell the storm coming, hear the crackle of electricity in the air, and, above it all, Tiffany's laughter. If she'd been a stronger witch, if she'd known more about this world, the way the other Kappas did, perhaps she wouldn't have fallen into Tiffany's trap. No wonder Scarlett was angry with her. She should be. She'd been forced to kill Tiffany because Vivi hadn't been strong enough to fight back. Was she a burden on them all?
Now, we have some minor housekeeping to attend to before we talk back to school parties, Scarlett continued.
Oh, good. Reagan perked up from the corner of the room where she was sitting with her back against the wall. Can we do a French Revolution theme? I just inherited a bunch of antique jewelry from my great-aunt Sylvie, including a bracelet Marie Antoinette was wearing the night before she died.
Ariana rolled her eyes and whispered, It's a good thing we don't guillotine people anymore for being out-of-touch one-percenters.
That'll be up to our new social chair, Scarlett said.
Her voice was steady, but Vivi could sense the effort required to maintain her composure. That had been Tiffany's old position.
I'd like to nominate a replacement. Someone whose hard work and dedication have already impressed many of us. Vivi?
For a second, Vivi looked around the room, confused. Was Scarlett asking her for a recommendation? Only when May raised a hand and said, Seconded. Did Vivi realize what Scarlett meant? She's nominating me.
Do we have any objections?
Scarlett scanned the room. Nobody spoke. Scarlett's smile widened.
Vivi, do you accept?
Now she understood why Scarlett had been acting strangely. She hadn't wanted to tip her hand before the meeting. A flood of pride rushed through Vivi at this sign of confidence from her big. Scarlett believes in me. Around the room, the Kappa's faces conveyed a range of expressions from surprise to excitement. And in Ariana's case, elation. Etta and Juliet were exchanging pleased smiles as if they'd known this was coming. May, too. Reagan looked vaguely annoyed, but when Vivi caught her eye, even she forced a smile. Vivi cleared her throat. Yes. Of course. Thank you.
Great, Scarlett said. Now, about those parties.
She cast another glance at Reagan, who leaned forward, genuinely eager now.
We'll be hosting the annual Pika Kappa Welcome Back Mixer here at the house next Friday.
Squeals of excitement broke out among the freshmen while the others watched in amusement.
After all the shadows hanging over our house from last semester, we will need to put our best foot forward, which is why I'm so glad Vivi has accepted her new post.
Some of Vivi's earlier excitement began to drain away. Social chairs were in charge of events, which meant Vivi's first big test as an officer of Kappa was already nearly on top of her. She'd need to throw the biggest, most impressive mixer Kappa had ever hosted. And she had less than a week to prepare for it. No pressure, right?
Chapter 3. Scarlett.
Something was wrong with Dahlia's grave. But as Scarlett stared at the Everly family tombstone with her little sister beside her, she couldn't place her finger on what. I just can't believe she's really gone. Vivi's voice sounded quiet in the hush of the graveyard. The same graveyard where, what felt like a lifetime ago, Scarlett had pranked Vivi and the other freshmen in their first hazing rite as Kappas. On the ground around the base of the headstone, heaps of flowers had been piled. Everything from expensive, professionally arranged bouquets down to little clumps of wildflowers, which Westerly students must have hand-picked. Then she spotted what was wrong. Between the lilies and carnations and other bouquets, pink roses.
She hated pink roses, Scarlett said, emotion rising.
No one hates roses, Vivi said automatically. then opened her mouth to take it back. I'm sorry, I didn't mean... But Scarlett didn't have time for Vivi's apologies. She was already dropping to her knees and pulling out the offending flowers. Vivi got down beside her and placed a hand on her elbow, stopping her. Hey, Scar, it's okay. She looked up at Vivi in surprise, surprised that she had lost her calm, and surprised to that somehow Vivi, the pledge she had dismissed at first sight, had become her closest confidant. The only best friend she had left. The lump in her throat swelled and ached. Scarlett tightened her jaw. If Scarlett was being brutally honest with herself, it wasn't the fact that the wrong flowers were here. It was that Dahlia wasn't. Scarlett gripped the roses that she had gathered tight in a fist and rocked back and sat on the damp grass. Hey, we can put them on one of the lonely graves, Vivi said gently. As Vivi took them away, Scarlett stared at the sea of messages. There were thank yous and we miss yous and we love yous from other students, sororities, cafeteria ladies. Everyone at Westerly knew Dahlia. At least, they thought they did. One note in particular caught her eye. It was next to a remaining clump of pink roses near her headstone. Scarlett picked it up. It was written on green stationery in elegant script. It only said, "We know it was you." Scarlett shivered. Dahlia always put Kappa first. She'd be a great leader. Dahlia had used her magic all over campus in small ways to create goodwill for Kappa. Or influence. Or power. Maybe someone knew how cunning Dahlia could be after all. Dahlia made friends with everyone not just because she liked them, but because she thought it protected us. Being a good witch is good for all the witches. Oh, Vivi said, absorbing this, and then added, she would have done anything to keep us safe. And ultimately she did. Vivi's hand came to rest on her shoulder. She'd be proud of you right now. Would she? Scarlett laughed without humor. I'm not sure she'd like the direction I want to take the sorority. Between her big sister Dahlia's ghost haunting her every step, and her mother and sister's constant pressure to be perfect, Scarlett's job felt impossible. Scarlett had been chasing perfect since she learned her first spell, and somehow, as close as she came, it always slipped away. Somehow, she always ended up at almost, and never enough. She respected you. She chose you. And she would know better than anyone that things were far from perfect, Vivi protested. Just then, a strong gust of wind picked up. Flower petals detached from the bundles at their feet and went skittering away across the gravestones. A few strands of Scarlett's hair pulled free of her ponytail and blew across her face. She reached up to brush them back. At her side, Vivi gasped. Look. Right in the center of Dahlia's nameplate, next to the feather perched a butterfly. It was beautiful. Fat-winged and glossy in the sunlight, a deep purple, almost black, that reminded Scarlett of the ravens themselves. She swallowed around a sudden lump in her throat as the butterfly's wings flickered, catching the sunlight. Dahlia. A moment later, it took flight once again, drifting high up over their heads, and seemed to vanish against the cloudless blue sky. See? Vivi smiled now, a real smile, the first Scarlett had seen from her since they returned to Kappa House yesterday. Dahlia agrees. You're going to be a wonderful president. Scarlett couldn't remember the last time she'd been nervous for a date. Is this a date? She wondered as she strode across campus toward the main green. Jackson hadn't been specific. When Jackson had texted her 2 days into winter break to ask whose number this was and why it was in his phone, it had felt like fate offering Scarlett a second chance. She'd lied and told him that it must have been there from a group text for philosophy notes, and he had bought the lie. And it should have stopped there. But
Jackson texted again, and again. But the more they'd texted, bantering about her snobby sorority and the moral implications of conformism, the longer the conversations had stretched on, and the flirtier the emojis became at the ends of their sentences, the guiltier Scarlett felt. Let's grab coffee now that we're back on campus. That could mean anything. A coffee date, a friendly invitation to catch up. Jackson had gone through so much with her last semester, tracking a rogue witch, Gwen, uncovering the truth about what happened to his stepsister, Harper, finding said rogue witch's murdered body, then helping Scarlett track down her killer. Kissing Scarlett. Every night, when she closed her eyes, Scarlett pictured it again and again. The bench overlooking the Savannah River, the way his lips felt, warm and soft against hers. The trusting smile in his eyes as he took a long sip of the tea she'd brought him. Tea laced with a powerful potion to make him forget. The guilt twisted again like a knife. She paused to check her reflection in the window of the science building she was passing. She had gone simple and classic today. A pleated mini and blazer, with a silk blouse underneath. Cut low, but not too revealing. Coupled with her high pony and her armful of notebooks, she looked like back-to-school perfection. She might be on a date. She might not. Who knew? Who cared? She was Scarlett Winter. No boy could rattle her. With one last grin, Scarlett started back on her way. When she rounded the building, she spotted him immediately. A head taller than the group he stood with, his head tipped back mid-laugh. Scarlett stopped for a moment and took him in. Jackson looked somehow effortless and irresistible at once, in a plain t-shirt and mildly torn jeans. His brown skin was warm in the sun, and his fade had grown out a little into tight curls. Nothing else had changed since she last walked away from him. Sensing her gaze, Jackson turned around. With one last word to the group, he jogged across the green to meet her. Her heart kicked into higher gear. They'd been texting all break, but she hadn't seen him in weeks, and he didn't remember how close they'd gotten last semester. Would he hug her right now? Kiss her? Her lips tingled. She still remembered their kiss, even if he didn't. But when Jackson reached her side, all her worries melted. He leaned in, as casual as if he had done it a million times, and kissed her cheek.
It's good to see you.
His eyes in the afternoon sunlight looked light brown and warm and sweet. You too. She glanced past him. Friends? Across the lawn, the group he'd abandoned were not so covertly staring, probably wondering why Jackson was talking to Scarlett Winter, of all people. She wiggled her fingers, and at least three of the guys jumped and looked away.
The Young Philosopher's Club I told you about, Jackson replied.
Scarlett arched an eyebrow and smirked.
How could I forget?
You know, I'm heading it up this semester. We were just making plans for our first meeting.
He fell into step beside her, leading the way toward the Grind, everyone's favorite campus coffee spot.
You should come. If you liked Follett's class last semester, you'll love our debates. It's this Thursday in the Taylor Common Room, after hours.
Actually, the club sounds like fun.
Jackson looked genuinely surprised.
Really? Scarlett Winter joins the Thinkers Society? That has to be a first.
Because sorority girls can't be thinkers,
she said lightly.
I did not say that. I just wasn't sure you'd have time, what with your busy social calendar and all.
Scarlett side-eyed Jackson.
Do you judge every sorority girl by your preconceived notions?
Only the most captivating ones, he replied, with a wink that made her heartbeat stutter.
Then he added,
But there's something suspicious about how perfect she always seems.
Her mouth went dry. They had wound toward the center of campus, where rows of tables had been set up alongside the green. Each one advertised different events and activities in the coming semester. She spotted a crew table with an entire boat propped up, and another group passing out free muffins to advertise their baking club.
Oh,
I don't know about perfect, Scarlett said, her voice as lighthearted as she could manage. I had a bad hair day once.
He burst into laughter.
Ah, yes, my mistake. Let's settle on nearly perfect, then. 99%.
She smirked.
Of course, if we're talking grade percentiles...
If this is about you scoring higher than me on the semifinal again, I swear.
But he nudged her shoulder playfully as he said it.
It's not my fault you can't remember your can't.
Well, since I can't wait for Young Philosopher's Club,
he snickered at his own joke.
I'd love to find some other time to pick your brain. Maybe over dinner?
He eyed her again, and once more her pulse skipped.
Okay, that was definitely a date.
Before she could reply, he held up a palm.
Hey, before you say anything, there is something you should know, Jackson said, suddenly serious. When I first started texting you, my motives weren't exactly pure. When I first found your number in my phone, I thought it was some kind of fate. I wanted to know more about Kappa.
Scarlett exhaled a breath she didn't know she was holding.
We don't allow boys to join. Not yet, anyway, she said, trying to lighten the moment.
Jackson gave her a small smile.
I wanted to know about Kappa because it was where... what I thought I lost my sister to.
Jackson, I can explain, she began.
He shook his head.
Something came over me. Some kind of peace. It wasn't Kappa's fault, it was an accident. And it was wrong for me to be angry at Kappa or suspicious of Kappa. And then I realized you weren't Kappa, you're you. You're Scarlett. And all I want...
What do you want?
She echoed, as he stepped forward, getting closer to her.
Is to attempt to make dinner for you and watch a really good bad movie.
I want that too.
Except for the dinner part. Let me help. I know my way around the kitchen.
Because of Minnie.
Yes,
she beamed, delighted that he remembered from her texts.
But tell the truth. You don't want to be seen in public with me because you don't want the thinkers to see you with me.
No, it's not that. It's just that I'm saving up every spare dollar at the moment.
They fell into step again, and she watched him from the corner of her eye.
Are you? What for?
Road trip next summer, Jackson replied. My sister, Harper, and I had planned it back before, well, you knew her, I think, right? Your freshman year?
He rubbed the back of his neck. Scarlett flinched.
I did,
she managed to reply. Harper had died their freshman year in a terrible accident at Kappa House. Tiffany and Scarlett had been there, inadvertently caused it, in fact. A secret Tiffany had made Scarlett swear to take to her grave. Last semester, Jackson had finally learned the truth about Harper's death, gotten closure. But now, so many secrets. How could anything possibly work between her and Jackson when she had so much to hide? Jackson was shaking his head.
Anyway, I still want to go. For her, you know?
I get that.
Scarlett looked away toward the clump of tables they were nearing. The rest of the students bustled around campus, seeming totally unaffected by last semester, by all the death and pain. But Scarlett had been changed irrevocably. The same way she imagined Jackson must have been after Harper's death.
Hey, Scarlett glanced back over at him, an idea forming. Don't you cater events?
That was where she had first spoken to him outside of class. He had worked an event Dahlia threw at Kappa, what felt like a lifetime ago. Jackson lifted an eyebrow.
Why? Are you in the market?
Actually, yes. Pretty often, in fact. We have a mixer next Friday. If you need more shifts to pick up or anything.
His expression brightened. Scarlett could get lost in those eyes.
Okay.
I might take you up on that.
Welcome back, mixer, next Friday,
someone yelled, and Scarlett was shaken back to reality.
Theta Omega Xi had rented two folding booths and pushed them together in the middle of the green, draped in their sorority's colors, green and pink. The whole thing looked so preppy and put together, Scarlett might have mistaken it for a Lily Pulitzer pop-up shop. They'd set up a dry ice machine in a pink cooler, and girls kept reaching into it with dramatic flourishes, like they were performing a magic trick, pulling out reusable water bottles monogrammed with WC, Westerly College, and handing them to passersby. Scarlett would have bet money they were filled already, and it sure as hell wouldn't be with water.
"Are they serious?"
she murmured under her breath to Jackson, just as one of the girls in a tight plaid skirt caught sight of her. Kappa had already announced their welcome back mixer for the same night. Scarlett remembered the girl. She had tried to pledge Kappa the same year as Scarlett. She had managed to light a sparkler, barely, but failed the second initiation test. Not enough magic in her to make a full witch. Scarlett remembered every girl who ever pledged, but especially those with a little bit of magic. But this girl's name escaped her. Katie? Catherine? Something like that.
"Scarlett!"
the girl cooed, and shouldered through a gaggle of freshman boys, trying to talk Maria, Theta's president, into giving them a second round of not-water bottles.
"I'm so happy to see you. We wanted to invite you and your Kappas especially."
She held out a leaflet done up in a pastel version of the colors on the table. "Welcome back, pregame."
"We didn't want to impinge on your party or anything," the girl was saying.
Kate, that was her name.
"It's just, Theta hasn't hosted anything big in a while, and we thought, since your party doesn't usually start until late, we'd give everyone a pregame spot to head beforehand."
"Did you?" Scarlett replied, her tone as cool as her stare. "Or is it to try and smooth over your bad reputation while messing with ours?" Kate's gaze jumped from Scarlett to Jackson and back. Then the girl peered more closely at Jackson and batted her lashes.
"You're welcome, too. Are you new on campus? I haven't seen you around before."
Scarlett battled an instant, bone-deep dislike. Jackson, however, looped an arm around Scarlett's waist, and some of her defensiveness melted.
"Nope. Been here since freshman year. It's a big campus once you step off Greek Row, you know."
Scarlett fought to keep a straight face and passed the flyer back to Kate.
"I'm afraid Kappa will be busy getting prepared for our own event that night. Tell Maria we're sorry to miss it."
"Tell me yourself,"
replied Maria over Kate's shoulder. Theta's president wore the same plaid skirt as her girls. Had they gotten uniforms this year? How 1990. But she had paired it with a gray sweater that set off her dark hair and pale complexion well. Maria was one of those pretty girls who knew it and took full advantage.
"Maria,"
Scarlett regarded her coolly, Jackson's arm still wrapped around her waist, tensed.
"I was just telling Kate that we won't be able to make your party, since, as I'm sure you recall, we have our own event to prepare for that evening."
"Well, that is a shame."
Maria's smile was all teeth.
"We hope to get the whole campus involved. You Kappas get such a great turnout, but last year I heard a few people saying they weren't sure if they could go. Plus others said they wished parties started earlier, so they could last a little longer. I thought, brainstorm, why not fill those voids?"
"Yes, well," Scarlett's jaw tightened, "I'm sure your party will be so much fun.
Here's hoping they don't get the whole campus drunk before ours even starts."
"Of course it will. After all, haven't you heard? Exclusivity is out. Westerly's going to be all about inclusion now, which means Kappa, the most exclusive sorority on campus, is out."
The words stung, and they didn't ring true. The Kappas were the most diverse sorority on campus, except for one thing. They all had magic.
"Still carrying a torch for Kappa, I see,"
Scarlett snapped back.
Maria laughed. "I prefer roses to feathers now. I don't know what I was thinking. Feathers are so last year."
Scarlett's eyes traveled to a pink rose pinned to Maria's lapel. It was the identical shade to those on Dahlia's grave. Next to the note, "We know it was you."
"Maria, who leaked your handbook last summer?" Scarlett asked, feeling bold.
Maria's smile froze over.
"Karma's a witch, Scarlet Winter. You'll see."
Witch? Scarlet's heartbeat quickened. Surely it was just a botched attempt at a turn of phrase. Before Scarlet could reply, Maria spun away, waving a flyer like a battle flag. So Eugenie was right. Theta really was coming for Kappa with a vengeance. And whether or not Dahlia really was responsible for Theta's fall from grace, there was one thing Scarlett knew for certain. There would be hell to pay.
Chapter 4. Vivi.
Vivi smiled as she slid into the chair Mason had pulled out for her. Before moving to Savannah, she would have cringed at these gestures of chivalry, especially from a guy her own age. Mason held doors, stood up whenever a woman left the table, and would have given his jacket to the ghost of Lizzie Borden if she'd looked cold. Yet Vivi had come to realize his behavior stemmed less from adherence to old-fashioned gender norms than from a genuine desire to make life more pleasant for everyone around him.
"Did I already tell you how beautiful you look tonight?" he asked,
brow furrowing with mock consternation as he sat down and placed his napkin in his lap.
He had taken her to a French bistro with outdoor seating along the river. The trees were wrapped in fairy lights and lanterns hung from the boughs like oversized versions of the fireflies glowing around them.
"You did," Vivi said,
pleased that it was warm enough to forego a sweater. She had borrowed a romantic pale pink dress from Ariana and didn't want to cover up the flattering sweetheart neckline.
"But I won't object to you saying it a few more times." "Noted. I'll set a reminder for every 12 minutes, Mason said, as he pretended to reach into his pocket for his phone.
Vivi laughed and leaned across the table to smack his arm playfully, accidentally knocking over a bottle of balsamic vinegar in the process.
"Oh, shoot," she said,
as a stream of dark brown liquid began to stream off the edge of the table onto her dress. But instead of seeping into the fabric, it skimmed right off, as if Vivi were wearing a raincoat.
"Is your dress okay?"
Mason asked, as a busboy came and wiped off the table.
"Totally fine," Vivi said, with a relieved smile.
Sonali had performed a fixing charm on Vivi before she'd left, to ensure her hair, makeup, and outfit stayed perfect throughout the date.
"I love this spell so much," Sonali had said, though it always drove my teammates crazy when I'd leave the pool after a long swim meet with my eyeliner still in place.
Vivi appreciated all the help she could get. This was her first time alone with Mason since before Christmas, and she didn't want any mishaps to spoil their evening. She'd been weirdly nervous about meeting up, convinced that despite all the time they'd spent on the phone, they might not have the same chemistry in person. But her nerves had drained away the moment she opened the door to Kappa House and saw him grinning at her on the front steps.
"So, how is it being back?" he asked. "I'm sure it's tough, being in the house."
According to the press, Dahlia and Tiffany had both been killed in a freak tornado that had swept through the woods behind Kappa House. It felt both comically far from the truth and somehow perfectly apt at the same time. A heartbreaking, violent tragedy that extinguished two young lives. Mason knew that Vivi had been out in the woods as well, and while she obviously couldn't tell him that she'd been kidnapped by a demonic witch who'd tried to remove her heart, it had been a relief to be able to talk about the traumatic events in more general terms. How terrifying it had been, how helpless she'd felt against that kind of power, how guilty she felt for surviving when others didn't. She'd been honest about the emotions, at least, if not the exact details.
"It's hard," Vivi replied after a long pause. "Every time I walk past either of their rooms, or visit Scarlett and Dahlia's office,"
Mason nodded sympathetically.
I can only imagine. How's Scar doing?
Vivi tried not to bristle at the implied intimacy. Mason and Scarlett had parted on good terms last semester. At least, until Scarlett had caught him and Vivi kissing way too soon after their breakup. But Scarlett had forgiven them, and to judge by the breathless recap she'd given Vivi of her date with Jackson, she was already moving on.
She's doing as well as can be expected, I guess.
Mason shook his head wearily.
Losing your two best friends at once? It's beyond cruel. Maybe she should have taken the semester off or something.
Vivi raised an eyebrow, and Mason laughed.
That doesn't sound like her, does it? No, you're right. It's probably good for her to keep busy.
She's already tackling the presidency with her usual force of will. It's nice to see her back in action. Scarlett's main focus right now was Kappa's alumni reunion next month, celebrating the 150th anniversary of the house's founding. The alumni were flying in from all over the world and included a Pulitzer Prize winner, a supermodel turned startup founder, a former Secretary of State, a famous actress, and two senators. The current Kappas were in a frenzy of excitement, especially the seniors, who knew that this would be a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for networking. However, Vivi could barely think about the reunion right now. She still had so much to do for the welcome back mixer, her first big responsibility as social chair, her first chance to prove to everyone that Scarlett had made the right choice, or prove that she was in over her head.
Vivi?
Mason said. She shook her head and saw the waiter staring at her expectantly. Oh, sorry. She glanced down at the menu she'd forgotten to peruse. I'll have the bouillabaisse, please.
The bouillabaisse?
The waiter repeated, his lips twitching as he corrected Vivi's botched pronunciation.
Very good, mademoiselle.
Vivi's cheeks flushed. Apparently, all the magic in the world still wasn't enough to keep her from embarrassing herself. Before she could stop herself, she cast the memory-wiping spell she'd been practicing, one of the few she could cast without speaking a word aloud. If all went well, the waiter would never remember her blunder. Sorry, Vivi said after the waiter had wandered off, a slightly dazed look on his face. See? This is why Scarlett was nuts to make me the social chair. I can't even order at a restaurant. How am I supposed to plan fancy parties? I'm still so new to... She caught herself, just in time to swallow the word witchcraft. To sorority life. And now I'm supposed to be running things? Mason reached across the table and squeezed her hand.
Come on, Vivi. Scarlett's a perfectionist control freak. She wouldn't have chosen you if she didn't know you could handle it. So when's the party?
Next Friday. I've got the first planning meeting with the other girls tomorrow. Vivi had recruited the other freshmen to help. She wanted the party to be a surprise for the older girls. Reagan had been all in from the start and had already sent Vivi a bunch of ideas, most of which seemed designed around specific items in her wardrobe. Bailey had worried they might need more experienced witches to help, but Vivi had promised they'd ask the upperclass women if they needed it. Mason ran his finger along the inside of her wrist, sending shivers down her spine.
Between your brains and your sister's help, I'm sure you'll knock it out of the park. And you know you can always call me if you need help with anything. I'm up for waiting tables, even.
Please. I'll need you to do the most important job of all. Hang out next to me and keep me sane all night.
That I can definitely do.
He winked, then unwound his grip, nodding at her empty glass.
Should we get some drinks?
He turned to catch the waiter's attention. Shit. Judging by the way the waiter's gaze drifted over their table, not noticing Mason's full-on wave, the memory-wiping spell had worked. Too well. While Mason's back was turned to her, she whispered under her breath,
I call upon the Ace of Swords. Your attention to him soars.
The waiter snapped to attention and beelined in the direction of their table. After Mason ordered, the waiter bowed his head deeply and then took off so quickly it looked like he was about to break into a run.
They're very, attentive here.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.